working together in Baghdad translated the Greek works into Arabic. And this is how cross-fertilization of knowledge across civilizations took place for the first time in human history. Before this, development of knowledge had taken place. Creation of knowledge had taken place. And the best example of creation of knowledge was Takshashila in India. For 400 years, Takshashila produced outstanding thoughts. It was at Takshashila that Chanakya developed his mind. It was at Takshashila that Charak developed his thinking on medicine. It was at Takshashila that Vishnu Sharma develops literature. For 400 years, Takshashila developed, but it was all indigenous knowledge. It was all Indian knowledge. And similarly, there were centers of learning elsewhere in the world. There was some work done in China and elsewhere. But it was the first time that through the efforts of Mamun of the Abbasid Caliphate that you had the bringing together of knowledge from different parts of the world to create a universal knowledge, to create a universal concepts and a cross-fertilization of knowledge. And this is how in the middle of wars, in the middle of conflict, one international think tank, very solidly backed by the state of Abbasid Caliphate, created the reality of Vasudeva Kutumbakam through knowledge, bringing together this knowledge of over 1500 years. If they had not done that, we would not have known much of the knowledge that was developed in India ourselves, or we would not have known much of the Greek and others. It was all totally lost. I mean, Aristotle today, Aristotle's importance today is all due to the Abbasid Caliphate. You would have never heard of him. Now, interestingly, there was a war between the Abbasids of Baghdad and the Umayyads of Damascus. And the Umayyads went to Spain and they settled there. The Abbasids took over the what is today Syria, Baghdad, so Damascus. And they settled in Spain in Cordoba. And they took over part of Spain and part of southern Europe. Now, while the Abbasids translated works from Greek and from Sanskrit and from the Chinese into the Arabic, the Umayyads translated the works from Arabic to the Latin. And eventually, then with the European Renaissance and the developments that took place in the Europe in the 14th, 15th century, the work got translated slowly from Latin to the Indian language, to English. So the algebra that your students are, your children are studying in the, or grandchildren are studying in the schools in Mumbai today, has traveled from its birth in India to childhood in Arabic to Latin to English. So the civilization that we see today is really a joint venture. It's a collaborative venture. It would be absolutely ridiculous for Americans to say that they have developed science and technology which is capable of taking you to Mars, because it has a foundation of last 2,000 years. You can't ignore. If there had been no mathematics, you wouldn't be having any space science. Your entire space science is based on computer science, physics. All these sciences are further based on mathematics. There would be no medicine today had there not been the work done by Avicenna and other people during the Abbasid Empire. So the civilization today is a collaborative effort. Your knowledge, your livelihood, your habits, everything, this microphone, everything today that is produced has come as a result of 2,000 years of collaboration. And it's only through knowledge, and it's only in the sphere of knowledge that the idea of Vasudeva Kutumbakam has been created. In the area of politics, in the area of resources, you have conflicts. In the area of land management, you have conflicts. In the area of economics, you have conflict. But despite all these conflicts, beginning with the Abbasids up till now, you have used the knowledge to really create the oneness of the universe or a shared value or shared premise for the advancement of human civilization. And what is happening today? This tradition is continuing. One of the most interesting experiments that's taking place right now as we speak is in producing the fusion nuclear energy. See, currently the nuclear energy is fusion by splitting the atom. But the biggest development that will ever take place in nuclear energy will be if you can fuse the two atoms. That experiment is taking place, and it's happening in France. And who are the people who are collaborating there in an area which is extremely sensitive? It's nuclear energy. It's not just nuclear energy, but it's the most advanced nuclear energy. And who's working together on this? The Chinese and Indians, along with Europeans, Arabs, and Israelis. In an area which is the most security sensitive area, they are working in France. They are not only deploying, and this is not the Indian scientists living abroad. These are the Indians in India. These are not PIOs. And these are not Chinese resident of California. These are Chinese in China. And if you analyze the budget, which comes out on the 28th of February every year, you would find, if you analyze last year's budget, for instance, you will see in the expenditure line about 100 crores given by the government of India to ITER, this International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor. Last year it was 100 crores, every year the amount changes. So every year the government of India from our taxes is contributing to this experiment. And so it is, in the most advanced area you have the collaboration taking place. You would remember that a few years ago there was this epidemic of SARS. And unlike AIDS, SARS just disappeared. The fear of SARS just disappeared in a matter of few months. At one stage it looked like SARS would kill millions of people. How did you manage to control SARS? What you could not control, we have not been able to control cancer, we have not been able to find solution to tuberculosis that fast, though tuberculosis is now coming in control. We have not been able to manage so many other diseases. How did we manage SARS, which was a completely new virus? How did you manage to control that in a matter of 1 year or so? It's because the moment SARS broke out, laboratories in 13 countries worked together. And they worked in a collaborative way. And this is how, within a matter of few months, we could contain SARS. And there were laboratories in India, there were laboratories in US, there were laboratories in China again, in Europe, they were working together. So the concept of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, that is of cross-fertilization of universal values, because at the end of the day, what matters is the values. And the knowledge expresses the values. So that is taking place for last 1500 years. And it's happening even now. It's happening much less than it should happen. That's a different question altogether, but it is happening. You have the Large Hadron Collider under Geneva, on the border of France and Switzerland. 75 countries are collaborating. There are 7 universities in India which are participating in this. And this is not just the TIF. TIF, of course, is a leading partner. But even you have the university in Punjab and Haryana and in Madhya Pradesh participating in this research. So you have the humanity has used knowledge to really bring about cross-fertilization of ideas, cross-fertilization of thought processes, cross-fertilization of values through this knowledge. And if you really want to make Vasudeva Kutumbakam or oneness, universal oneness, or the concept of universe as a family, the world as a family, then you need an instrument. And a shared development of knowledge is one instrument which has been proved over the last 1500 years, and which is what will help you to go ahead. In recent Indian history, one thought leader who understood this very well, and that was Swami Vivekananda. This year there is a 150th birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda. From last September, I got several invitations to come for 150th anniversary celebrations. I turned all of them down. Because when I asked these organizers who were organizing these events about how much actually they are following Swami Vivekananda's teachings, all that they could tell me was that they are doing some social work. There was nothing more concrete they could provide. And I'm not talking about one or two organizations. I'm talking about a large number of organizations. No, social work is good. I'm sure Swami Vivekananda would approve of social work. But that was not core to his message. How many of you have read the Chicago speech? How many of you have read Chicago speech, the text? Yes? So if you read, you will see the speech which was given on the inaugural day. The key words that he has used, it's that all religions in the world should follow the principles of universal acceptance and tolerance. These are his precise words. These are not my words. These are the words of Swami Vivekananda. And in fact, he was speaking in old English, so he didn't use the word tolerance. He used the word toleration. But I would translate it into the modern English to say toleration to tolerance. Okay. And then again, towards the end of the speech, he comes back and he emphasizes that what we need is the universal acceptance and toleration or tolerance. He didn't say Hinduism is more superior to Islam or Islam is more superior to Christianity and all the religions should be in conflict with each other. He said the key to a healthy society, a key to a desired society, is for all religions to understand the principle of universal acceptance and tolerance. That was a key message, but that was only one message one part of the message that Swami Vivekananda gave. There was a second part of the message that Swami Vivekananda gave after he returned to India from there. And that second message was that philosophy itself is not enough. See, the first message was more or less philosophical. That philosophy must go hand in hand with technology. And which is why the first scientific institution in the country was created by Swami Vivekananda, not by any scientist. And he got financial assistance from Raja Wadiyar of Mysore and from Jamshedji Tata, of the Tata Group. So with their financial assistance, he launched a study for the a Society for the Study of Science, study and promotion of science. And from that society came into being the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. So Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore is founded by Swami Vivekananda, not by a professional scientist. And because Swami Vivekananda belonged to an era when India was not independent and there was no politicians running the government, or unfortunately there were foreign rulers running the government, there was no force on him to accommodate somebody's son or daughter as the director. And as a result, Swami Vivekananda had a freedom to invite somebody who really deserved and who really knew how to run that institution as the director. And he chose a person. Initially there were a British director just in the setting up stage, and then later on the person who took over the director was Dr. C.V. Raman, who went on to win the Nobel Prize in Physics. So Swami Vivekananda understood that the way you can bring about progress of a nation, the way you can build a nation, and the way you can create stability and peace in the world, the linkage between the two, because you cannot live in a nation peacefully if the whole world is unstable, and you cannot work for a stable world if your own house is not in order. And the way to do this is to promote the concept of universal tolerance and universal and acceptance of all religions, and secondly, to promote the scientific temperament. And that these two things have to go hand in hand. So in today's world, if you really want to create the concept of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, which has been given to us as a gift by the ancient rishis and the ancient sages in India, what are the lessons that we can draw from the last 1500 years of history? First of all, one lesson which is clear from the Abbasid experiment, from the message that Swami Vivekananda gave, and the message that and the experiments which are taking place at ITER and everywhere, that it's only through collaboration that you can progress. There is no alternative to collaboration. There is no alternative to cooperation. And this collaboration, this cooperation has to happen at all levels. Not just collaboration between institutions, collaboration between different constituents of the society, collaboration between different religions. And unless and until an Indian political party comes with an agenda, comes with a program as to how different religions, different castes, different segments of the society, of the Indian society, can creatively and constructively work together, we will not realize our full potential. That is absolutely essential.